Hello, you're watching this video because you've been scheduled for a total hip replacement. I know you must have many questions. I hope this video will answer most, if not all, of your questions. In the video, I'm going to describe the anatomy of the hip, list indications for hip replacement, describe the procedure and the attendant risks and complications, and lastly, I will talk about the postoperative care you will receive and your expected postoperative course. Please follow along with the presentation notes that we've provided, and I'll be happy to answer any further questions you have at your next visit. Let's get started. The main indication for hip replacement is failure of non-operative treatment for pain secondary to arthritis. Hip replacement is also a treatment for hip fractures and a lesser known entity called avascular necrosis. In most cases, arthritis causes loss of cartilage surfaces lining the acetabulum and covering the femoral head. The smooth surfaces are degraded, leading to irritation, loss of motion, and pain. When the pain affects activities of daily living and does not respond adequately to non-operative treatment, it's time to get a hip replacement. The hip joint is covered by multiple muscle groups. There are several ways to approach the hip for hip replacement. Most approaches to the hip involve cutting or releasing muscles and tendons. Some approaches, however, are muscle sparing and get to the hip between muscles. Which approach is used is based on surgeon preference and characteristics of the patient, such as weight, height, and muscular build. The hip joint consists of the ball, called the femoral head, and the socket, known as the acetabulum. The hip is a true ball and socket joint. During hip replacement, the acetabulum is reshaped to accept a metal cup. A plastic liner is then locked into the metal cup. On the femur side, the femoral head is removed and replaced with a prosthesis that goes down into the thigh bone and has an upward metal projection which holds the new ball. The femoral prosthesis is made out of a titanium alloy. The ball is usually metal as well. We will rely on the architecture of the components and your musculature for stability. The procedure usually requires a relatively large skin incision. As mentioned earlier, there are multiple approaches. In general, I use an anterolateral approach, which means that I enter the hip joint from the side and frontal aspect of the hip. This approach has both a muscle cutting method as well as a muscle sparing method. The method chosen depends on patient characteristics mentioned earlier. Each approach has its pluses and minuses. The anterolateral approach gives very good visualization and results in a very stable hip. A short-term limp is more common with an anterolateral approach. Wound closure is normally with staples, but can be adjusted for patient preferences. Patients usually have surgery, stay overnight, and then go home the next day. Home health care is normally set up before surgery and is provided for approximately 2 weeks. Outpatient therapy starts after those 2 weeks and then goes on for approximately 4 to 6 weeks. If you live alone or do not have any significant local support, you should expect to stay in the hospital for 2 to 3 days and then be sent to a skilled nursing facility for 7 to 10 days. The incision must be clean and dry for the first 2 weeks after surgery. Also, I advise avoiding submersion of the incision for 4 to 6 weeks. As mentioned earlier, you will be on a blood thinner of some kind for 10 to 14 days, as well as being asked to walk frequently and possibly wear compression stockings. The length and type of anticoagulation depends on your history and risk for blood clot. You will follow up in the office at 2 weeks, 6 weeks, and 12 weeks after surgery. After surgery, you should expect some level of pain and gait abnormality for 4 to 6 weeks. Please pay attention to the physical therapy instructions on the limitations and best ways to perform activities of daily living. Over time, you will regain strength around the hip and normalize your gait. A hip replacement under normal circumstances should last about 15 to 20 years. Hip replacements are successful approximately 90%+ of the time. Success being defined as a patient saying, "I'm glad I had my total hip and I would do it again." It's not uncommon for patients to have some residual pain after hip replacement. Patients can also have residual limping. A limp is a learned behavior, and it may take time to unlearn it. Both the residual pain and limp are usually temporary and are overcome by time and therapy. Complications in total hip replacements are unusual. Infection occurs approximately 1% of the time. You will receive antibiotic treatment before and after surgery while you are in the hospital. All efforts will be made to try to discharge you to home as soon as possible, decreasing exposure to hospital infections. Blood clots also occur approximately 1% of the time, with a smaller percentage of those becoming pulmonary embolisms. Pulmonary embolisms are blood clots in the extremities that go to the lung and can be life-threatening. You will be placed on some form of a blood thinner after surgery for approximately 14 days. If you are not currently on a blood thinner, then most likely you will receive aspirin. Standing and walking also decreases your risk of blood clot. There is also a small risk of nerve injury. During surgery, the sciatic nerve can be stretched, causing a weakness in the lower extremity, resulting in foot drop. These are almost always temporary issues, resolving within a month or two. Another complication is instability. This means that after your surgery, your hip pops out of place. After surgery, you will be told and taught certain restrictions to decrease the risk of instability. The last complication I will mention is leg length discrepancy. When your hip is replaced, there is a chance that your lower extremity will end up longer or shorter. Although leg length is very important, it must be understood that stability is the priority. If needed, your lower extremity may be made longer to provide better stability. Leg length discrepancy, however, will be minimized. In conclusion, hip replacement generally is successful, but it does have its risks. Following instructions after the surgery, as well as working hard in physical therapy, is crucial to success. Appropriate expectations are also very important, and the effect of a positive attitude cannot be overemphasized. I hope that this video was helpful, and again, do not hesitate to discuss any other questions with me about your total hip replacement at your next visit. We want this process to be positive and beneficial for you so that you can get back to enjoying the activities that you love.